William S. Ungerman, president of the United States Training Center, is a seasoned combat vet who served with both the 101st Airborne and 25th Infantry Division in Vietnam. Bill participated in various covert missions, including a prisoner rescue raid into Cambodia. An accomplished student of military history, Bill maintains a working knowledge of most significant military campaigns and is well educated in the military tactics and strategies of most countries in the modern world. After completing his military tours, Bill served 10 years as a policeman in the city of Long Beach, California. He currently teaches military-themed adventure courses and through the USTC continues to teach both military and police personnel tactics and strategy. Bill has also been retained to protect special dignitaries such as Bishop Desmond Tutu, shown here with Bill. Now your host, Bill Ungerman.
Focus on here. It is better to have a coordinated squad than an uncoordinated mob. 9 to 12 individuals who know what they do, who know they do well, and know where they're going, and know what they're supposed to do, have an objective, have a goal, and apply these principles will be much more effective than 200 individuals who are merely out there to get their gun off, so to speak. All right. What is the composition of a squad? Well, our squad, for our purposes in this game, shall consist of, number one, the squad leader. That is the person responsible for the maneuver, deployment, and employment of the squad in various factions, in various means. The assistant squad leader. Should the squad leader become a casualty, the assistant squad leader now becomes responsible for the maneuver of the squad and for the well-being of the squad and for carrying out the squad's objectives. While the squad leader remains a viable force, his job is now to carry out the directives of the squad leader and also to command any portion of the squad should that squad be divided up into two separate maneuver elements. As we'll see later on, there are occasions in which you can, in fact, facilitate the objective and goal by breaking the squad up into smaller elements, or, if you choose, the fire team. Now, on the move alone, we develop some other elements of the squad. And those elements, which I feel are probably necessary for the paintball game, are, number one, the point team. Now, a point team should consist of, at a very minimum, the point man. That is the lead element in the squad, in the advance, in the field. Followed up closely behind him by what we will call the slack man, the person who, for lack of further development, picks up the slack of the point man and covers the point man. So it is the slack man is actually the rear security for the point man. Now, if you have a 9 to 12 man squad, your point team should consist probably of a minimum of two people. Now, other security elements within your squad on the move should consist of, at a very minimum, a rear security element, at a minimum of one person and possibly two persons. The rest of the squad is in itself a security element. They are charged with the responsibility of observing to the flanks of the maneuver element as you move forward in the advance. Every man should be assigned a sector of responsibility of observation. Now, should your unit be in open terrain, you will also consider having some kind of flank security on your maneuver, on your maneuvering squad. And that will have at least probably one person on each side of the squad in whatever formation you choose, whether you choose to move in a file, a column, a wedge, in some kind of echelon formation, whatever you choose to move in, at least your flanks are covered. In normal, thick cover, in which you gentlemen are accustomed to occupying and operating in, you'll probably be constrained to either the file or the column formation while moving down the trail.
Before we continue, I'd like to add parenthetically that despite the fact that we've described the squad as being composed of 9 to 12 members, for the purposes of people watching this tape, we want you to be flexible enough to apply that to be able to either expand or compress that figure to suit whatever type of a organization that you are currently playing with. The tactics and strategies that we are talking about in this tape apply to as few as 3 individuals and to as many as 30. The theory is the same. The application may vary, but only by the numbers of persons. So we want that to be understood. What we're going to cover from this point is what is known in the military as immediate action drills. These are the counters to the classic clashes between ground units. In the case of paintball game, opposing teams meeting. Now, the encounters can be characterized basically by 3 categories. Number one, enemy sees you, you don't see enemy. That is what also is known as, sorry about that, as Sin Loi, as you say in Vietnam. That means you've been spotted and you haven't spotted the enemy. Now what results from this type of encounter is an ambush. You are likely to be caught in a hasty type of ambush set up by enemy personnel. Now the second type of contact
is what is known as a simultaneous contact, or what is known in the military as a meeting engagement. You will note the euphemism characteristic there, the meeting engagement, just a chance meeting between you and them along the path. That results in a contact that the outcome will be determined by your own special tactics, spirit, elan, and mission. We'll go over that more thoroughly in a minute. The third in these scenarios, and you notice they're improving now, we've got the worst case, the probable case scenario, and now the best case scenario, is you see the enemy and they don't see you. This results in your ambushing them. Ambush. That is bringing fire on a moving or temporarily halted enemy by fire from a concealed position. Or mass mayhem at point blank range. That's what we're attempting to do here. Now the ambush you will be setting up will be what's called a hasty ambush. A hasty ambush. That is one that is not premeditated, but one that is merely carried out by what we call SOP, the standard operating procedure. And you develop the SOP through training and communication and prior knowledge of your fellow warrior. You know what's going on by practice and training. And you were able to institute this at an instant without having to sit down and negotiate and plan. Because it surely must be done in a heartbeat to be accomplished successfully. All right, so those are the three basic areas of concern. The enemy sees you, you meet the enemy spontaneously, and you see the enemy. So let's go back to the beginning and talk about the first category, and that is where the enemy sees you, you don't see them, and this results in you being ambushed. In this situation, your unit is caught in what is less than euphemistically described as the kill zone. We try to say that with a smile on our face. The circles represent the opposition. The triangles represent your unit, and tip of the triangle represents the axis of advance, that is, in that direction. Now we'll assume for the purposes of this first illustration that your entire unit is caught in the kill zone. And you see we have a four-man maneuver element at this point. Now, this is a probable scenario, but it is one in which we hope that you never have to face. And if it is, I hope it's strictly with paintball. In this situation here, if the opposing force has in fact done their homework and done everything properly, the likelihood of your survival is nil if it's done correctly. However, since we never say die and we always hope that there's some type of solution, let's look at the possible solutions from the extraction from this type of situation. Now I want you to note, and let's talk about this for a moment, is the difference between the constant air gun versus the standard type of a gun. All these tactics presume not that anyone is armed with any particular type of weapon, because these tactics are designed to manifest the best in tactics and really de-emphasize the type of weapon being used. By all means, the team applying these tactics properly will be the winning team. You cannot rely on technology for your superiority. Technology will not make you the victor. Your superiority lies, gentlemen, in your ability to apply strategy and tactics. So let's look at it in this situation here. Caught in the kill zone, you immediately know your unit is taken into fire. The kill zone is occupied, and that the kill zone is defined as being that area which is taking under fields of observation and fields of fire. Because a kill zone, if it's not, maybe a field of fire potentially, but if it's not under the actual eyeball visualization of the opposing force, it really is not in a kill zone. So assuming that they have both visual and field of fire observation of you, you are caught in this situation. The standard solution is to turn immediately, not to go to ground, because if you go to ground in the kill zone, you are in the open, they are in cover and concealment. It is merely a matter of time before you are eliminated. Coordinatedly, the leader sounds the attack, and the charge should be through the enemy position, immediately, immediate assault. So number one, we're talking about immediate assault. Immediate assault, solution number one. A solution, by the way, much easier to perpetrate at the paintball level, more so than the ball ammo level. All right, secondly, let's assume that immediate assault, for whatever reason, is not appropriate or not an acceptable solution. For whatever reason, terrain too thick, too much of a space to cover. For whatever reason, you determine that it's not what it is going to be. Secondly, we have the Australian withdrawal. The Australian withdrawal. That presumes that the enemy ambush, the opposing force, paintball team ambush, is taken under immediate suppressive fire by your available assets. Suppressive fire, and you immediately begin a movement, either forward or retrograde, to be determined by the terrain. It cannot be determined in advance. You either move the unit in its entirely laterally to the linear ambush, all the time putting fire into the enemy unit, either in this direction or a withdrawal. Psychologically, most teams prefer to go forward, and there certainly is much to say for that.
Now, I have a question. How far apart are these four guys, or two groups of four?
You will certainly not be able to possibly identify individuals by their name tags, but you will certainly have some very cogent idea of the position of their ambush. I would say that you will know with a substantial certainty the direction and potential firepower of the enemy unit. In any case, you can't stay to ponder that. Whether you can identify individual enemy positions or not, certainly your avenues of withdrawal are going to be apparent. Now, you also have the possibility of moving in this direction here also. Okay? And in paintball, it is a viable retreat area, or a viable motion. We should not say retreat. The reason is because it expands the length of distance between the gun and you. So therefore, your ability to break contact is very quick. The only possibility that it would deter you from moving in this direction would be the vegetation or the terrain profile, which prevents you from moving in this direction here. Classically, the movement is either this way or this way. In addition, in paintball, you may in fact move that way or that way. You break enemy contact. Any questions on this particular tactic? All right, that's the Australian withdrawal. And assumes a retrograde or forward motion parallel to the line of the opposing force fire. All right. Now, our other option depends on our pre-planning and coordination and formation. Now, you note that, as we discussed previously, the effectiveness, the efficacy of these tactics depend on your prior knowledge, your establishment of the SOP, the standard operating procedure, the ability of every member in the team to know upon signal what we're going to do, because the best tactics in the world, uncommunicated, are no tactics. You must be able to have communication, and everyone must understand what that communication is. All right. The other possibility we have is by developing a unit formation that is characterized by a gap or break in the unit. Our A team and our B team, the Alpha and Bravo teams for purposes of this illustration. Now, in this illustration, as can be seen, only the Alpha team has come within the kill zone, The Bravo team has yet to enter the kill zone. In this case here, you have the ability to utilize the Bravo team as a maneuver element and to swing Bravo onto line to bring flanking fire onto the target. And thus break the ambush by using a maneuver element. This does not preclude A team from utilizing any other the previously described methods to break contact or break loose. They are not obligated to stay in the kill zone while and become these targets while Bravo team maneuvers. In any case, This maneuver here is known by various titles and names. I've heard described as swinging the gate, in naval terminology, crossing the T, if you prefer what they did at Trafalgar or something else like that. In any case, what it does is it provides what is known as enfilade fire on the enemy unit. Enfilade fire being described as fire delivered along the long axis of the target. As we can see, this is the long axis of the target, is it not? Now, as you can see, in this situation here, your fire from this maneuver element is delivered along the long axis of the target, and the impact, the beaten zone of your weapons, falls among all the enemy units. Should you miss one, it goes on beyond, etc. That's the theory, in any case. Now, with paintball, this may need to be modified to an extent, and you may, in fact, need to advance this unit in a sweeping charge through the enemy unit. Now, you notice, in addition to maximizing the effectiveness of your weapons, it also minimizes the effect of the enemy's weapons. By masking the weapon, you are faced with one opponent at a time only. You may, in fact, neutralize opponent one, opponent two, opponent three, opponent four, while not having to deal with more than one opponent at a time. Secondly, we want to cover what is called the meeting engagement, and that is the simultaneous contact between you and the opposing force. You and the opposing force in a simultaneous, unplanned meeting. Again, we're assuming that these, for the purposes of this illustration and for the purposes of application to reality, that meeting will likely occur in a narrow corridor type of a situation, because otherwise, if it occurs in a horizontal or linear plane, the likelihood of you spotting enemy forces will be substantially increased. So the chances of a spontaneous meeting occur will likely be enhanced by the chance of your unit moving down a narrow corridor, such as a jungle trail or something like that. Okay, in the case in which you are moving in a file formation in a narrow corridor, which you probably restrict your movements like this, and you meet an enemy unit approaching in the other direction, there are several solutions possible under this scenario. What you do will depend on a number of factors. Number one factor will be the mission. What is the mission of your unit? What are you attempting to accomplish? Are you a flanking force? Are you a recon force? Are you an assault force? Are you actually searching for their flag? What are you? Do you already have the flag? What is exactly your mission? That will be the number one determinant of what your actions are. Secondly, and almost as important, will be the relative strengths of your unit vis-a-vis the other unit. Now, assuming that you have overwhelming strength, that you are backed up with 12 or 14 or whatever size unit, and you are facing a 3 or 4 man enemy unit, in that case, assuming that the mission allows, you have overwhelming strength and you have the ability to overwhelm enemy forces. In that case, the best thing to do is to possibly bring as many people online as possible as the narrow corridor will allow, and again, bring that fire, as we know as enfilade fire, on the enemy unit, advancing as much as possible to overwhelm enemy forces in piecemeal fashion before they have a chance to organize themselves into a viable defense. Overwhelm the enemy immediately. Immediate assault down the corridor, massing your firepower. One of the principles of war, mass. You want to mass firepower to your front immediately. These formations, that is the file formation, do not lend themselves to massed firepower to the front. They have effective mass firepowers to the flank, but firepower massed to the front is not one of the best features of this type of formation. You must, in fact, change the formation immediately to take advantage of that to hit the enemy unit. Our second alternative is, what happens if the enemy has overwhelming force against your force? Or, let's say the mission somehow precludes your engagement of forces of like size. In that case, you have available to you what is known as the commando withdrawal. The commando withdrawal. Commando withdrawal, also known as the peelback. Peelback. Now, immediately upon confronting opposing force in front of you, the point man, and this does not establish any distance between point man and the rest of the unit for the purpose of this illustration. But in any case, the lead element in whatever, however you choose, chosen to designate your unit as a squad or team or whatever you'd like, when that first lead element makes contact with the lead element of the opposing force, he or she, as it were, sets up a base of fire to the front, immediately establishes a base of fire, and suppresses enemy fire on your unit, or at least it makes the enemy go to ground or begin to do something else. Immediately upon that, the second member back in the team takes up a position of relative security toward the flanks of the corridor or whatever you're in, and begins to take ready as this individual fires and now moves to the rear. Takes up and moves to the rear, now creating a gap between these two units. Likelihood of an initiative based upon to close the gap is slight. Most units, unless they're extremely well schooled, disciplined, and know what they're supposed to do, will not immediately close the gap on you. You will, possibly, but not them. Again, second element takes up the fire to the front, and as he clears, he or she begins moving to the rear. Until, continuous type of action, until all elements in the unit have now created a huge gap between enemy units before they've recovered and understood what's going on, and before they can move forward in any type of action, no matter how coordinated, you will no longer be there to be coordinated upon. All right, in this third scenario we'll be developing, you don't have to play catch-up. In this situation, the best case scenario, you have observed the enemy and they have not observed you. So with the fates and luck on your side, we'll now develop and show what happens when you catch them in an ambush. Now, in order for you to properly deploy, you must have, again, to reemphasize, that standard operating procedure. Each member of your team must, in fact, know exactly what he or she has to do at the time of the observation. There's no time to sit down there and explain to everybody what their particular assignment and what are they supposed to do. Now, the enemy unit, the paintball team, advances down the trail, and for whatever reason, better observation, terrain advantage, whatever, your point man observes their unit coming. At that time, what is necessary for you to do will depend again upon the mission, as you recall. If in fact your mission is reconnaissance, finding out where the enemy flag is if you don't already know, or to determine what the enemy's defenses are in defense of that flag, or for whatever reason, if in fact you anticipate that you will not engage them, you have the opportunity at that time to hide, that is, take up a position in which you can conceal yourself as the opposing force paintball team passes you by. However, if in fact your mission allows or your disposition persuades that you wish to engage and destroy, then in that case, what we will do is we will take up the hide, but with the eye to engaging the opposing force unit. Now, when we do so, and when we select a hasty ambush, there are not that many considerations for you to adopt. When you are taking up an ambush position on a predisposed location, much more thought and care goes into the establishment of the ambush. But when you establish an ambush on such short notice, as it were, you are basically constrained to take what you get. What you see is what you get. You got two choices, really. You could go to this side of the street or this side of the street. That's basically the only thing you want to do. And that decision should be made by the squad leader, the team leader, or whatever. And that decision should be based solely on two considerations. Number one, fields of fire, and fields of observation. With some consideration, if possible, with avenues of escape should that unit prove to be overwhelming in firepower. But assuming that you are at least evenly matched, or you have, in fact, the superior firepower, we will not consider avenues of escape from the ambush site. So assuming if our only considerations are, in fact, fire on the kill zone and observation on the kill zone, we move to the left or to the right. For the purpose of this illustration, let us move off in this direction here. So the unit moves off into the brush, taking up positions in which they can observe the progress of the opposing force paintball team. Now, as the unit approaches, you should let, as you identify the size of the team, you should let the entire team come into the kill zone before initiating fire into that area. Should you be premature in that, you will cause yourself the same situation as we discussed in the first scenario. That is, you will create a situation in which you have engaged half the unit, allowing that other half to do what to you? Yes, flank you and bring that God-feared enfilade fire down your axis of your target. And whatever we want to do, we want no fire on our axis. So, to avoid that, we wish to bring the entire maneuver element of the enemy into your kill zone. However, that's not always possible, and that's not always the way it goes, because ideal things seldom work out that way. So if this does in fact happen, be aware that this may in fact be the result, and you may in fact have to break off part of your ambush element to provide a security element to counter a flanking motion. Should you be so lucky, so skilled, or a combination of both, to bring the enemy unit within your kill zone, you should be able to dispatch them with post haste and send them back to the referees splattered with your colored paint, with a minimum of casualties on your side.
Question?
Yes.
Instead of making your squad go from one side to the other, how about a third choice? They can go head on. That way they can take out the other squad with more firepower, since you are taking them by surprise.
Why would you want to give yourself away in that sense? I mean, are you proposing to be on the road and then attack?
Right.
Well, how do you get on the road?
Well, you're already on the road.
Okay, so at some point before you can open fire, I would submit that they're probably going to see you. So you are giving up precious secrets here. You are letting yourself be identified for even if it's a split second, you are giving them a chance to organize. Whereas if you're in undercover and concealment, you're giving them nothing. This is mass mayhem at point blank range.
Giving them ground?
Well, I don't think that you have not seen them from 3,000 meters away through heavy lenses. I assume this contact is being made at 50 to 100 meters away. If that is the difference between victory and defeat for your flag, well, I would submit then possibly let's modify this to do something else. Certainly they are being allowed to come that much further into your territory, if you will, but I would submit that it's probably not going to be critical, because by doing so, they no longer exist as an enemy, as an enemy element.
Another question.
Yes?
Why not let them just see one? Let the one stand out on the road, let the other four, the enemy, come down the road so that you can unleash a
all right.
Firepower. When they're only thinking about the one guy, all of a sudden they get hit by four or five guys.
All right. That's a possibility, although let me tell you where that applies. Again, I ask you to consider, if in fact everyone is undercover, you have all your firepower developed, and the enemy will invariably and inevitably come into your kill zone, why do anything else? Why provide a decoy when no decoy is needed? If the ducks are flying into your gun barrels, why throw out decoys you have to pick up later? They are coming by. Now, where that question of yours has some responsiveness is in a situation in which, let's say, there's another trail that leads off here. The enemy unit is approaching here. Now, if you suspect that the enemy unit may in fact take this trail and in fact get behind you or in fact take a different direction, then in there, a situation where a decoy is provided certainly provides that necessary element to draw the enemy into your trap. But where you are situated, set up, and ready to go, why screw with you? Lastly, we want to cover one more thing, and that is possible formations that you can adopt that will effectively bring your unit into contact with the flag of the opposing force and your ability to recover. Now, your formation will depend upon, and what formation you adopt will depend on the types of terrain and your mission. Basically, the first type of formation we've got would be a file formation. Now, the start with the advantage and disadvantage of the file formation. File formation has got minimum firepower to the front and to the rear. It's got maximum firepower to the flanks. Should you be caught in flanking type fire, you can immediately draw fire to the flank. It is the probably the only type of formation that you can move through heavy vegetation with some modification. If it's very, very heavy, you're basically constrained to this. You can modify this to a certain extent and adopt what is known as the modified column or ranger column by staggering your file into a two-column type of a configuration, which basically has all the advantages of the file with some of the actually maximizing some of your advantages of some other formations. It gives you a little bit more firepower to the rear and front. In fact, it doubles your firepower to the front and to the rear. By the offset here, no fire is masked in either direction. So either file can deliver fire to either of the flanks without fear of engaging one of your friendly forces. So that is the modified column or ranger column. Okay, advancing through other types of terrain, your options become more open. You have the wedge, the three-man wedge. You have the lead element and the two supporting elements moving in this direction. That unmasked fire in all directions for all parties. All parties can deliver fire in all directions. The opposite of that formation is called the V formation. Again, the direction, the axis of advance is in that direction there. And for whatever reason, this gives you slightly more firepower in the frontal condition, while again unmasking your fire for all elements through all directions. You also have what is known as the echelon. Again, the axis advance is this one. This one here happens to be an echelon left. And of course, you could do it the other direction with an echelon right. Your standard attack formation, once you're at what's called the line of departure, is the line, and everyone is on line, and that can be used to advance your unit towards an enemy position for the final assault. Now, these various formations can be adopted based upon the terrain and the actual condition present at the time that you choose to go into them, and can be modified at any time. All right, if you are in combat in village, if you are engaging in one of the many numerous paintball fields now that are being built up and having a combat in village type of scenarios, there you're going to have to employ some type of fire and maneuver. Now, fire maneuver is basically going to break down to one or two individuals. These are formations for movement prior to contact. Understand that. Once in contact, these basically are breakdown. These are maneuver elements while you're moving. When contact is made, you're going to have to adopt at that point. Something makes the difference. So don't confuse these with elements in contact. These are formations for movement to contact, for formations and movement to contact. Once contact is initiated, again, to reemphasize, you must in fact be flexible enough to employ that tactic and technique that works. Largely, it's the employment of individuals covering each other and that type of thing. Things disintegrate in both paintball and infantry combat. All right, now that we've seen the theory on the chalkboard, we're going to go out in the field, and you gentlemen will have an opportunity to put these into action. Let's go out in the field and do it.